That was the trailer for To Five Bloods, the new Spike Lee drama, war drama, if you will. That's now streaming over on Netflix. And man, Spike Lee's been on a roll. I tell you, he's been on a roll. I'm not even talking about that's the role that started with Black Klansman. I'm talking about the role that it was even before Black Klansman, talking about Chirac, talking about Red Hook Summer, the movies people have been sleeping on, but got woken up 2 years ago with Black Klansman and how fantastic that film was. He follows it up with another strong one, another incendiary one in To Five Bloods, a movie that's got a lot of good performances, and I would say is mostly successful at delivering a thoughtful, topical, and timely story. I'm not as high on it as Black Klansman, and over time I'll reveal kind of why. I'm not as high on it as I really am some other Spike Lee movies, like Get on the Bus, Do the Right Thing, even Red Hook Summer, which I think is criminally overlooked. But we'll start with you, Dominic. Your thoughts on To Five Bloods, just general thoughts, acting, commentary. What'd you make of it?
Yeah, what struck me the most about this film is that Spike Lee, as usual, he just pulls no punches. But he also leaves no cultural touchstone unturned, to the point where the film is simultaneously like the most immersive museum you've ever visited of the Vietnam War. You know, you're like, it's like constant references, and not like in a Bad Family Guy kind of way. Actually, you know what? It almost feels like a kind of a Family Guy-esque kind of. It's a weird comparison to make. I'm sorry, but like
the cutaways.
The cutaways, and you know, to the point where there's like an explicit like 10-second history lesson of African American Olympian Edwin Moses, and it's like, what the hell was that? But it's woven in. It's clearly on the nose, like so on the nose, like a clown nose, but it's actually also seamless, because like if it was any other director or writer doing this, like Aaron Sorkin comes to mind, who's like really known for being on the nose and preachy and whatever, but if it was any other other director doing this, yeah, exactly, we would be violently groaning and like, oh, come on. But because it's Spike Lee, because you know he has this history, he's been screaming the same message over and over again throughout many of his films, and he's been so in this game that it just works. It works. It has that gravitas behind it, and the fact that he is able to tackle such a not even like a decade, but like just a generation of what it feels like to be a generation of American history, and he levitates that gravitas with including Marvin Gaye's legendary soundtrack, What's Going On. If any director is going to use that, you know, they better have something to say. And he absolutely did here. And overall, this film just hits you right in the face with just how that feels like. And I would not be surprised to see this. To me, this is another Vietnam War classic. It's not even like a true war film, yeah, because it takes place after the war. But in some regards, most of it does. But it's just such a amazing culmination of that tense, ultra tense feeling that, as Steve mentioned, resonates so well with us today, because we might very well be part of that or seeing mirroring that in today's political climate.
Yeah, I mean, we could probably take two shows and talk about the real density of this movie, too. I mean, for starters, the two things that struck me were it's really an homage to Apocalypse Now, number one. And then the other one is the Humphrey Bogart movie, which you're seeing a lot in discourse, is The Treasure of Sierra Madre, which I'll just forewarn, I have not seen. I've seen Apocalypse Now a couple times. Haven't watched The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, but it's very similar to, and even Delroy Lindo's character, who I'm sure we're going to get into, even his character is kind of modeled, his sort of decline into insanity is modeled after Humphrey Bogart's character in that film. I mean, hell, they go to an Apocalypse Now themed bar in the movie. I mean, which I didn't even know those things existed, much less in Vietnam. But apparently, I don't know if they decorated it or whatever. I kind of want to go to an Apocalypse Now pop-up bar. That's one thing I didn't know that I needed up until this film. Joe, your general thoughts, though, general musings on To Five Bloods.
Like Dom said, it's not really too much of a war film, because the only time it's actually in the Vietnam War is during flashbacks. But a key thing about those flashbacks is that the actors are still playing those same characters. So, like, Delroy Lindo is still playing the younger version of himself in that scenario when they have a flashback to the Vietnam War. And I've seen tons of people talk about this, like, you know, how much they didn't like that, how much they thought it was weird and kind of out of place, like a choice. To me, though, like, the way I saw it is, especially with Delroy Lindo's character, these are all veterans who are still kind of stuck in that mindset of the Vietnam War. And then when they're put back in Vietnam, they just still think they're there. And that's why when you have these flashbacks, like, you see them as those people because they're still in that, they're still that character. They're still, like, in that mentality that, like, when you have these flashbacks and it's their older version, it's just them there. It's still them. I thought that was actually a really interesting choice. I'll get into, like, one thing that did throw me off about that later on once we get to, like, negatives, but I just want to start off positive with this. Going off of you, Steve, I will say, like, in terms of other Spike Lee movies, this is kind of lower on my list. That doesn't take away from how good this is, though. It's a great Spike Lee movie. And compared to everything else we have this year, it's like this and Bad Education are just my favorite films so far this year. Like, you know, when it comes for, like, time for us to do, like, a, I don't know, at the end of the year, it might be a top five for all we know. Top five, bottom five.
Of the five films that came out this year.
Like, Bad Education and The Five Bloods are definitely going to be on there. That's how much I did enjoy this. And Delroy Lindo's performance is amazing. I'm sure we'll get into it soon. But I really did enjoy this film. And if you haven't checked it out on Netflix, with everything going on, it's still timely. Especially, I mean, one of my favorite moments of this movie, something I really didn't know, was... when the Vietnam Vietnamese people came on the radio and would contact Black GI telling them, like, hey, you know, you're out here fighting this war. Why is there more African-Americans fighting out here than white people? You know, back at home, they just shot Martin Luther King. Like, you know, you really want to be fighting for this country that's doing this for you? Like, I thought, like, I'm like, that is something I never knew about the Vietnam War. And it's just like, wow, Spike Lee, thank you for teaching me something today that my history books and classes never did.
Which is the best thing
Spike Lee always does.
He does that a lot. That's absolutely the case. He gives you, like, a history lesson of, like, okay, here's what they didn't teach you.
Yeah.
And Dom even brought it up, too. It's not like, you know, for some filmmakers, it'd be on the nose. But it helps, though, that Spike Lee's been around since the late 80s. He's been doing this. He's not hopping aboard the civil, you know what I mean, like, the racial injustice train.
Yeah.
Or the reparations train, like, over the last couple of years. He supported Colin Kaepernick and Black Lives Matter even long before Colin Kaepernick ever took a knee, you know, and it was forced into the living rooms of people. I mean, Spike Lee's been at this forever, and he is really an authoritative voice that you pay attention when he when he talks. You listen when he speaks. And that's exactly what's happening with The Five Bloods and how it hooks you like that. I'll go on to and even say the performances here are great. The performances are really strong. I love the core five, like Isaiah Whitlock Jr. Delroy Lindo, he's coming for that Oscar. Mark my words.
Yeah.
If we do have a virtual Oscars this year, or the Oscars in some way, shape, or form, Delroy Lindo's coming for that Oscar. He's an early pick for Best Actor for good reason, too, because he plays such an interesting type that you don't see, that you really do not see in movies. He plays like the disenfranchised, like, middle class black voter who is a Trump supporter. That's brazenly clear in the movie.
Yeah.
Who is, like, angry at just the perceived injustice. It's almost like he's in a way angry about the wrong things, though, or at least he's redirecting the energy in a very, you know, negative way by supporting somebody for president who doesn't support him and doesn't support his causes. And that's why they go back to even Vietnam to try to recover the gold that their fallen comrade Storm and Norman. I love that name, by the way. Storm and Norman. Played by Chadwick Boseman. And I'll just add this, too, to go off the performances, too, and then I'll throw it back over to you, Dom. Chadwick Boseman, he's an interesting actor. The problem with Chadwick Boseman, though, at least in most of his roles, is that he always feels overshadowed by, like, supporting performances. The same happened in Black Panther immediately comes to mind. And even, like, he's been, like, the biopic actor. It's like anytime they're making, like, a safe biographical movie on, like, a black, you know, legend, like James Brown. Jackie Robinson. Mm-hmm. You know, they call on him. But Chadwick Boseman does some really fine work in this movie. And I don't want his performance to, you know, go untouched. I think he really does well in this. He's a great actor. I'm not saying he isn't. He just often feels overshadowed by supporters. With that, I'll turn it back over to you, though, Dominic. More thoughts on the Five Bloods.
If Chadwick Boseman is like the blackest motherfucker out of the slate of actors that I've seen so far, and it's like he's going for so many icons that he might as well. If by the end of the decade he doesn't play like an American Black Panther like a period piece, I'd be surprised. No, but like. These are astounding performances from the four main leads, of the older leads, who are in their older ages. Delroy Lindo is 67. Clark Peters is 68. Isaiah Whitlock Jr. is 65. The youngest one is Norm Lewis at 57. And the fact that they're able to cover a wide spectrum of emotion so authentically, so beautifully in a kind of a different genre for African-American actors, and even to the point where they're in their old age playing, you know, in battle scenes, like war film scenes, somewhat clumsily, I get that. But honestly, like with those battle scenes, I immediately noticed, yeah, they were kind of corny and cliche and even a little confusing. But here's the good thing about being Spike Lee, if you're like a legendary director at this point, because you can just make excuses. Because he has just such a specific style. You could even say he was going for like the corniness of like 60s and 70s war films, where there were like, there's the point where when someone gets shot, they're doing like this thing, like, oh no, I got shot. Oh no. And like the blood is like oversaturated, which is like what Tarantino would be like satirizing, but he's just going for it here. And whatever. So you could even make that that comparison, but I agree with Joe that it's awesome that they were able to play themselves without any makeup. There were like some snapshots of them where they were in younger makeup, but the fact that they were playing that's like artistic license. Yeah. If you don't get that, man, I don't know what. Mm-hmm. But this movie runs the gambit and is just an amazing exploration. And I don't know, do we want to get into Delroy Lindo? Because that's like the big one here. And actorship out of all of them. And I don't think anyone here is a drain at all. But Delroy Lindo here takes the cake, to the fact where he has like two big ones where he is doing a straight up staring at the camera and just by himself talking to the camera, which I have not seen done so well since there was an obscure Jean-Claude Van Damme film. I don't know if you guys saw this. It's called JCVD, and Jean-Claude Van Damme plays himself as like a kind of a somewhat parody of himself, as like a down on his luck washed up 80s actor. But then he gets caught in this hostage situation, and he has this long like 7-minute monologue where he's just going on about his life. And the fact that Delroy Lindo is able to capture that, and even more so, and just sum up the insanity of the Vietnam War, what it's like to be a Black American in that specific war, and at an old age as a disaffected person who has been betrayed by his country, betrayed by both political parties to such a disgusting degree. Because don't forget, you know, LBJ was a Democrat, and he brought the country into the Vietnam War under horribly false and just big, you know, horribly false premises and lies. And then the fact that, that's why he turns to Trump in so many ways. He captures that so brilliantly in the spirit of Apocalypse Now that if he doesn't get a nomination, man, that's, you know, screw the Oscars even more so.
No, he captures that anger. I was just going to say, he captures that anger extremely well. And that disenfranchisement, which I think is the key word there when you're looking at him. Like, he's been abandoned by both parties. So he looks at somebody like Donald Trump the way a lot of people did 4 years ago and even to this day, where he's just like, screw it, blow it up. He's anti-establishment. He's never been a politician. You're sick of the political rhetoric of all these people, well-meaning presidents or whatever, that are talking about bringing change, but then they retain the status quo. You know what I mean? I say this before. I said, I get why Trump won. I don't like to agree with it. I really don't. But I get why he did, and I get why he attracted people like Delroy Lindo's character and people like him. You go ahead, Joe.
No, I was gonna say, man. Like, the thing I love about those monologues is like it doesn't even like take me out of the film either, because his character deals with PTSD, and they even talk about how like he talks to himself at night and everything. So I always just saw it when he was doing those monologues, talking to, directly to the camera. It's just his PTSD getting to him. He's either addressing Stormin Norman or just somebody he thinks he's talking to when he's having these monologues. Like, and good just like point. The fact you can take these monologues and you actually make it still part of the story, and it doesn't take me out. Like, oh, like, you know, like a film that comes to mind is like the Dick Cheney movie. I forgot. Vice.
Yeah.
And then The Big Short, where they have like these, you know, fourth wall breaking moments where the character addresses you like directly, or just a cameo from a celebrity. And it's like, it's fun, it's goofy, it's a nice style that whatever that director his name is, Adam McKay, I think.
Adam McKay.
It's a nice style he has to like both those movies. They're fun and everything. They fit with that movie. But like, it takes you out for a second. You go like, okay, I was involved with the story, but now I'm out of the movie, and it's like, here's a funny thing that took me out of the movie, and now I have to get back into it. With this, it's like, I never once broke out because he was, like, addressing me directly. I was just even more pulled in because of that. Because, hell, again, like we've been saying the entire time so far, all these guys are great. Like, they're great together. The minute they're on screen together, it feels like friends reuniting, man. It feels like you're at a barbecue with them, the way they interact. And, like, they're, like, you know, shooting the shit with one another. But Delroy Lindo, yeah, he steals the show, without a doubt. And he should get an Oscar, in my opinion. I mean, like, there isn't that much competition so far this year, other than, like, Hugh Jackman, really. But, like, I think he's got it.
I mean, the other thing, too, is that, I mean, after, like, weeks and weeks of just lazy, you know, filmmaking that we were seeing on, like, Netflix, like, movies that were coming out, like, I mean, we reference this, it's become a meme of the new show, Coffee and Kareem, The Lovebirds, like passionless filmmaking in a way. After even months of that, because, I mean, we were still even the dregs of January, it's so refreshing and reinvigorating to see a movie. It's not perfect, but it's ambitious.
Yeah.
And it's lofty, and it makes you think. I think my main criticism with the movie, though, however, is a weird one, and this is how I'll try to like frame it. I've noticed something when directors do movies for Netflix, like the biggest example you could bring up is Scorsese with Irishman. They give them like, I mean, it's a director's wet dream in a way. they give them all the money. They give them a huge amount of money. They give them final cut privileges. They give them writing and creative privileges. They give them the whole everything. They give them the whole house, pretty much, to make the movie they want to make. And I love The Irishman. It was one of my favorite films of last year. But it's kind of the same problem, though, with The Five Bloods. There is so much in this movie, and there's so many, like Don was mentioning earlier, cutaways and diversions. It doesn't fit as well to me.
Yeah.
Like, the complete puzzle as Black Klansman. It's sometimes there's, like, subplots that don't develop, like Clark Peters' character, his relationship with the Vietnamese hooker and stuff. You don't get that. You don't get development on that front too much. Much, you know, which is kind of disappointing. That was the main problem I had with it, is like, it's overstuffed. I mean, you could probably take about 20 minutes off of this movie easily and still have a more complete film, because I like, the best part of this movie was watching the soldiers interact and walk across that field. And God, that, I don't want to, you know, overload the discussion too much here before I toss it back, probably toss it over to you, Joe, after this. But that minefield scene was so great.
Oh, man. That's where the movie, for me, it turned around, like, completely. Because I was enjoying it. I was having a great time watching them interact. But there were things that kept taking me out. One is the thing you were talking about, Steve, where it was, like, you had these distractions coming in and out every once in a while. And I was like, man, like, and I would check the runtime and be like, ah, shit, like, this is going to be a long one. All right, like, please, man, like, pick up some speed. But the minefield scene from there on out, like, the film takes off. And, like, I think it's great that Spike Lee took his time and actually gave you a lot to care about all these guys on this trip. Even Jonathan Morris, David, who's Paul's son, Delroy Lindo's character, even their tour guide. Like, I mean, you care about all of them when they're thrown into dangerous situations like a minefield and in, like, where it escalates from there because, you know, fool's gold. But the other complaints I had was, I don't know about you guys, to me the music in this film, not like the Marvin Gaye stuff, like the, like whoever did the soundtrack, like, you know, the score, I guess is what you want to say, whoever composed it, kept taking me out of the movie constantly. I don't know about you guys, but like when it was just scenes of them in the Vietnam War, and I get like what Dom was saying was like it's kind of like making fun of like that cheesy 60s era like music, that was fine when it was used there. But when they start using it in modern day for when, like, the characters interacting with each other and it's playing, like, the same patriotic horn and everything, it kept taking me out of the scenes, man, because it started to make some of the dialogue they have, especially near the end of the film where, like, they're about to have this big action sequence and they're like, I don't know if I'm going to make it out alive. You know, there's a lot coming for us. And they're playing, like, the most cheesy war music that's featured, like, in, like, every, like, World War II film that came out in the 60s and 70s. I thought, honestly, it was kind of distracting with the music in the film. Other than that, though, I really have no other complaints other than, like, yeah, it was too long, overstuffed. The older actors, I liked them in there when they did the flashback scenes, but, like, for action scenes that went on a bit long during the Vietnam War era, it was kind of like, all right, it's kind of a bit sloppy and looks clumsy, but, like, I can forgive it. But the music was really taking me out. Other than that, though, I think the film's fine.
One comment on that. Isn't there some Creedence Clearwater Revival in there early, too? Isn't there some CCR? Yeah. It's not a not. My buddy and I always joke. I don't think it was Fortunate Son, though. I think it was Bad Moon Rising. That's the song. I'm a huge CCR fan. My buddy and I always joke. It's not a nom movie or a nom documentary unless you hear Fortunate Son.
Yeah.
It's a meme. It's a meme at this point.
Go on, Dom.
I was just going to say that the score, the original score, was written by accomplished jazz musician Terrence Blanchard. But, Joe, I completely agree.
Oh, that's your wheelhouse right there, Dom.
Yeah. Yeah, and he's great. He's accomplished, but, man.
Oh, I'm sure he is.
He's just wasted on this. His talents are wasted on this film. And I guess that's up to Spike Lee's fault because it just felt misused to the point where, if you have something sweeping and, like, so grand and almost, like, patriotic, seemingly. But then you have it in, like, the modern-day settings as opposed to the Old War set. It kind of contradicts its own message during that use.
Yeah.
And it just does not feel right. Even the end of the movie has, like, a sweeping, like, here's all the characters of the film. Delroy Lindo as Paul. Jonathan Majors as David. And it's, like, it's just this, like, strings and whatever. I'm like, what? This is not, like, the apocalypse-esque, you know, descent into madness that we were getting hardcore in this movie, but, like, what was that? So, yeah, the musical score was misused here. I mean, on its own, I'm sure it's fine, but it was just weirdly misused. On the complete other end of the spectrum, an incredible use of Marvin Gaye's What's Going On, the soundtrack, and many of his songs. Fan-frickin-tastic. Marvin Gaye's What's Going On, the album, is one of the greatest American albums of all time. And I think it was on Rolling Stone's number 2 of greatest albums of all time, beaten only by Sgt. Pepper, which makes sense for Rolling Stone, but still, man, if you have not listened to that, it's one of the few albums that, for me, I can listen to track one to the very last track, back to back to back, which makes sense because it's a concept album. But even then, it's hard for me to do that. I mean, the album itself is built to be listened in that way seamlessly because the tracks do not stop, kind of, sort of. But the messaging, the feeling, the spirituality of What's Going On is so epic and so majestic and so of its time that if a director or anyone is going to use that song, that album, in their Vietnam 60s whatever film, it better mean something. And the moments where Spike Lee did use Marvin Gaye, did use that specific song, was absolutely beautiful. He even pulled the trick of just using the lyrics, just the singer singing by himself in a separated track, which is kind of like such a classic trick, but it's one that almost never fails me. Because it's so beautiful. And then, but yeah, going to like, shorted me about this film was just how it kind of like fell apart under its own weight, because Spike Lee is going for the ultimate Vietnam 60s, you know, the black soldier, the black American experience in this era. And I think the problem is not so much the cutaways, like here's like 10 seconds of African American history. It's not even that. Because hey, I don't know if we're of the times, but like, hey, I love that. I love that. I'll watch just Spike Lee doing that for an hour. But I think the problem is, yeah, as Joe was alluding to, just the jumbling of the its plot points. Like there's like a shootout towards the end of the film where it's like, I don't know, this is weird. I know functionally it kind of has to get to a certain point, but it's like contradictory of like being an anti-war film, and like, you know, it shows them trying to be like buddy buddy and like kind of like a friendly shootout. Not a friendly shootout, that's the wrong word for it, but it's contradictory in that like, are you trying to go for a descent into madness or a Sierra Madre-esque heist movie? You know what I'm saying here?
Yeah.
Which I should say I have not seen that movie either, but is it,
but
trying
there's
to be
a
like...
duality there that it struggles with sometimes. Yeah, because it's trying to talk about the black experience, but then you're going for like a heist movie too. Yeah. You know what I mean? They're it's weighty, and that's kind of the problem. I think you said it best, is it kind of crumbles under the weight of its own ambition.
And it you would really have to break that down scene by scene, whatever, but it just overall it did not feel as a complete package. And I think Spike Lee was just going in too many directions at once.
I can agree with that. We'll do star ratings on this one. Really glad we got to talk about this, though. You guys know I'm a diehard Spike Lee fan. I've been a Spike Lee fan for many years, so it's always a privilege to watch a new movie from him. And I'm glad that this one's gotten seen. You know, I would have loved, though, I was watching this thing, and I was watching it that night, or about 2 weeks ago, and I was just thinking to myself, I was like, damn it, I would have loved to see this in the theater. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. This would have been, flaws and all, just to talk about the theater experience. I really started to, I mean, I've missed it for the last several months, but I really started to miss it. When you watch a movie that, like, you could tell was even made to be seen, it's so sweeping and cinematic, this would have looked gorgeous on the silver screen. It's kind of disappointing we didn't get to see it that way. But that's the state of the world at the moment. I give it 3 out of 4 stars. I think this is a uniformly solid movie. I really think that it's an important film, and I think it'll age pretty well. I do, but its loftiness is its own problem in some ways. It's not so much the disjointedness, although it is kind of disjointed, but it's just lofty, and there's a lot in it, and it kind of makes for an exhaustive viewing. All that said, though, this is some passionate filmmaking, ambitious filmmaking, and I'll never knock that too much. 3 out of 4 stars. Joe, final thoughts and star rating.
Man, like, I had a blast watching this as well. Again, I wish I could have saw this in theaters. There's some amazing shots when they're walking across Vietnam in the modern day, like across farm fields and everything. And like, even I would have loved to have been in a theater just like gripping onto my seat during that minefield scene. I was already doing it in my chair at home, but like, yeah, I had a blast watching this. It really is. I had a blast watching this, man. I would say the film, and to me, this is better than The Opposite Effect, which, the film got better as it went along. And to me, it's worse when a film gets worse as it goes along. Like, it starts out strong and then it ends weak. I much more prefer it when it's like, it starts out pretty good, it has a few bumps, but the longer it goes on, the more like I'm getting invested, the more I'm liking it. I have to say the second half of the film really saves it for me. Not like, I should say save, but it bumps it up like another half star for me. For me, this is 3.5 stars out of 4 for me.
Wow.
Dominic, your nice. Final thoughts, star rating.
I think this is going to be up there in terms of Vietnam War classics, but it might be lower on the list because all the military enthusiasts out there, it's certainly not going to be, you know, Apocalypse Now, Platoon, or all of those. And it shouldn't, because it's not truly a Vietnam War film, but it absolutely captures the essence of what it was, of just the trauma and the madness that, honestly, I have not seen since Apocalypse Now, which is a movie I need to watch again. But it'll mess you up in many ways. And it's such a deep dive into these amazing, amazing characters that actually, you know, I could have gone for way more character development, as Joe, I think mm-hmm. Joe was saying. But even then, just the acting alone, the raw acting was able to elevate so much of that. Particularly Delroy Lindo, but all of them in their when they're in their 60s on average and they're doing like war scenes, and it works, and they're able to portray this exhaustion and this absolute insanity of their situation, both past and present. It's an accomplishment in itself. And Spike Lee, I call him the angry black man of Hollywood, and that's something I'm sure he would wear with pride. He is able to deliver with an incredible message, and just astounding visuals and montages. I could watch friggin' a half hour of a Spike Lee montage on anything, and he's able to bring gravitas to it. And while unfortunately, I'm actually kind of on the opposite end with Joe, where like the second half was kind of getting. Actually, no, I don't even know if I can do first and second half, but. Just like where it wound up, it was kind of like contradictory of trying to be slick, but also weighty at the same time. I don't know. It's hard to put together because it's such a muddy feeling at the end after the fact in culmination. But there's no doubt that Spike Lee still got it. He's always had it. And this is apparently, according to Wikipedia, his most expensive film to date, but only at $45 million. Which is pretty damn impressive. For reference, The Irishman was up to $250 million on Netflix. Yes. He's able to make something out of virtually nothing. Alongside his whole career, I got to give this a very solid 3 out of 4 stars. Man, 5 out of 5 bloods, man. 5 out of 5 bloods. I almost would like to see, I don't know if Spike Lee's done TV, but I would just love to see like a deep dive into these characters because there's so much there that I would have loved to have seen more.
Likewise.
Not just with Delroy Lindo, but all of them because there was so much promise. And yo, I got my Isaiah Whitlock Jr. shit out of that, which he just owns now. He just owns it. He does like all his movies, all of his TV shows, and he was sick of it at one point, but now he owns it to the point where he's selling bobbleheads. Hell yeah, dude. I love that.
I like the Shaft reference of the bad mother shut your mouth. I've dropped that in casual conversation the last couple of days, shamefully, but...